Hello and welcome to PDFSupply.com. Today we're going to be talking about how to test an RX3i thermocouple analog input card. I have here an IC695ALG312. As I said before, this is a thermocouple input. It has 12 channels. And a couple things before we get started, there's a few things I wanted to explain about this externally. First is, as you can see, I have the module in the CHS rack powered up. I have a blinking green module OK light, and you want to see that. If you don't have a light on here, or if it's red, then that would mean that there's something wrong with the card and you're not going to be able to follow this test. It would need replacement or repair. Okay. Second thing is that the terminal strip, this requires a high density terminal strip. You'll notice that there's 36 terminal screws on this particular terminal strip, and I have this lever here. What the lever does is it firmly attaches the terminal block to the module card itself, so it makes physical connection. And when it does so, you're going to get green lights, as I'm going to demonstrate, on your field status and your terminal block. And this is telling me that this is firmly attached and I have everything that I need in order to do the test as far as on the module itself. Okay. The next thing is you're going to need some sort of a thermocouple, all right? I have a test fixture here, which is a J-type thermocouple. It has positive and negative leads off of it. And just a quick brief description about what a thermocouple is it's two dissimilar conductors or two dissimilar alloy metals that contact each other at one or more points. And we'll say one point in this particular case, where a temperature differential is experienced by the different conductors. So if you've got this, like I have this J-type thermocouple, in a warm or a cold environment with the two metals touching at the end of the thermocouple itself and then being separated into the separate metals by a positive and a negative lead, you will be able to detect temperature through a millivolt value. Okay, it creates a millivolt signal or a millivolt measurable voltage value, and that's what we're measuring here. That's what this card is made for measuring. It's made for very sensitively detecting millivolt. Okay, and that's going to be important. And when we come to our description of configuration. Okay, the next thing is, if you notice, if you look at the door card that shows the wiring instructions on it, you'll notice attached to terminals 2 and 3 on the left-hand side, it says CJC1. That stands for cold junction compensator 1. And at the bottom of the terminals 16 and 17, again on the left-hand side, it says CJC cold junction compensator 2. The cold junction compensator is an optional element. It's not required to do the test that we're doing, so we're not going to use one, and it's not always required in the field to do one, okay? It's considered a reference junction thermometer. That's what a cold junction compensator is. It references a value that's the current temperature at the module itself, and then it's able to cross-reference the value that's coming in from the thermocouple itself, because sometimes the thermocouple's in such an extreme environment. So again, it's not always needed. Check your application and of where you have your thermocouple, and check with the manual to see if a cold junction compensator is necessary for you. Okay, so the next thing that we're going to be doing is doing the configuration I described before. I'm using Proficy Machine Edition. And what I've done is I've set up a new blank file with the RX3i format. I have my CHS007 slot rack. You can use a 012 or 016 rack for this. My power supply is using slots 0 and 1, and my CPU is using slots 2 and 3. And that leaves me with slot 4 as my next available slot to configure the 312. So you can right-click on slot 4, double-click, add module, analog input, tab, and then go to ALG312. Now here's where we're going to need to give some information in order to configure it. first thing to notice before we start this is that the channel value reference address, where our the first of our 12 channels is going to begin on percent analog input 00001. And I'm going to show you guys where that is when we get to the default tables. Channel 1 is the first one that I'm going to configure. Currently it's disabled with a 32-bit floating point format, and we're going to enable it in thermocouple. However, just for example, I want to show you guys voltage. Now, the range that you can choose from, as I mentioned before, the thermocouple creates a millivolt signal, a measurable voltage signal. So if you choose to use millivolt, or if that's the application you're using it for, here's the format that you use. You can use from negative 50 to positive 50, or negative 150 to positive 150 millivolt. All right, but we are using a thermocouple, so I'm going to use that. And you can choose, depending on the different type of metal thermocouple, the type. And we're using, as I mentioned before, type J. I'm going to use a 16-bit integer. And you can use Celsius or Fahrenheit, depending on what your need is. I'm just going to leave it as Celsius. Now we're just going to go through thermocouple, type J in my case. And we're going to just configure the first six channels. Again, go ahead and configure this the way that you would actually be using it in the field with the type of thermocouple you're actually using. There's many different applications. It doesn't matter if you choose, if you're using an E-type and you choose E-type, or if you're using millivolt and you choose millivolt, that's fine. You'll still be able to follow the test. It's still going to be the same. Let's go back through and make sure I get these all 16-bit format. All right, my configuration's good. So what I'm going to do now is connect up to our processor by hitting the lightning bolt icon. And once I'm connected to the processor, I'm going to hit the green handprint here to toggle to online mode, and then pause for a second. We need to check. Down below is our status bar, and it's telling me that the programmer is in programmer mode. The processor is not in run mode, it's in stop mode. The outputs are disabled, the configuration and the logic are not equal. This information is important because it's telling you that the processor was handling a different task before you've asked it to test this analog ALG312. All right, so because of that, we're going to go to target, online commands, clear. We're going to go to controller and IO fault table and clear those faults, those not equal faults that it's telling us about. Okay, yes. Now, if you don't do that, you're going to get hung up when we go to download, and which is the next step here. Download and start active target, this download information and start button. Now, if you're following me so far, you should be at this point where it's going to ask you, what exactly do you want to download to the processor? All right, and when it does ask, it's just the top two selections: hardware configuration in motion and logic. All right, there's no need to write anything to permanent flash memory. It's just a simple test. We're going to be probing the channels to make sure that they work, and that's about it. Okay. Then once we get into actually probing the channels, I'll tell you what to look for as far as potential problems. This is a good troubleshooting method to take a module like this, put it in a separate rack outside of whatever it was working in, and test it on its own, isolated, so that you can tell whether this card is good or bad, and it'll lead you to finding whatever your problem may be quicker. All right. Keep in mind, we have a lot of other videos too that describe how to test just about every RX3i 9030, 9070 products to help you guys narrow down problems. Okay, we're going to enable the outputs. Now, at this point, if we look down at our status bar, if you followed me properly, you should be in programmer mode, run enabled, configuration equal, logic equal. If you're not run enabled, and you don't have a run light on your processor, check your feedback zone and find out what's wrong. It's going to tell you what the issue is. There might be some configuration issue, and then correct whatever it tells you to correct. Another thing is, if it doesn't tell you that you have any issues, open up the battery door to your CPU. I'm using a CPU 320. Make sure that the switch is in the far right position, which is run with I/O enabled. Sometimes people will turn that switch to the far left position or the middle position, and it'll kick you out of run mode or with your outputs enabled. Okay, once that's done, we're in run mode. We're at the point where we can test this. We're going to go to default tables and expand them. And analog input. Okay, so we currently have some values here that those will change. Those are based on the reference values in our scaling for our configuration with the ALG312. So the first point, as you can see, I've got my arrow over here and it says analog input 00001. Top right hand corner. That's where we're going to see the first value. And what you want to do is, following the instructions that are given on the door card, start with channel number 1, which is on the left-hand side terminals, as is a 1 through 6, as a matter of fact, is all on the left-hand side. The positive lead goes on the top, terminal 4, and negative lead goes on to terminal 5. And we're going to hold that on there until we get a value, leave it on there. I have a value of positive 26, which you'd have to do a little bit of math to find out between the scaling what the actual room temperature is, but that's about accurate. What's more important is that, two other things. I'm getting a value, very important. You must first get a value, make sure that the circuit is working. And two, very important, make sure that the value is completely stable. Okay, since I've placed these probes on here, I've gotten a solid 26. It doesn't move around. It doesn't go up or down. If you have one that you're getting a value, but it's jumping all over the place, it's going from 26 to 23 to 31 and just back and forth, and it won't set on a certain temperature or value, that's definitely a problem card. We're going to continue to go down all the channels. Okay, I'm probing 2. Probing 3. As you can see, I'm moving over towards the left. Every other address is because this is differential type input, so every other address is going to be a value. I'm getting a solid value of 26, 27. I guess it depends on how long I put it on there, and also temperature change makes a difference. Okay, so another thing I want you to keep in mind to further this test, I'm just going to stop there because you guys get the point. You configure all the channels and you probe and test all the channels, obviously. But another thing that you guys should do in the field, which I do here, is I'll take a heat gun and I'll run my heat gun against the thermocouple element, and I'll bring the temperature up while I've got my probes against the terminal. So what I'm doing there is I'm trying to see if it detects that the temperature is going up. Second thing that I'll do is, especially if you have a sealed, like an aluminum sealed thermocouple that's in a enclosure, or you can wrap it in plastic and dip it into cold water after you've heated it up, and then you want to detect that the temperature is going down, okay? It's not so much to test the thermocouple itself as it is to test the ability for the card to read those changes in value, those changes in temperature. Okay, so if you want to be really thorough, here's what you need to look for. Look for a circuit that's, number one, working, that's giving you a value. Number two, that's giving you a stable value when you first test each channel. And number three, see if you're able to go back and test those channels with a fluctuating high temperature, low temperature type test. And just make sure that when you're probing these channels, it's not just giving you a value because you're technically in some sort of a way shorting it out like you would be with a resistor. You want to make sure that this is capable of doing what it promises to do, which is detect temperature. Okay? So, and obviously, you know, if you turn the module on and at any point the module OK light fails, it shuts off, or it turns red, any of those possible things would be a catastrophic failure, we would call it, and would need repair or replacement. So the analog, the IC695ALG312 is a module that we repair here at pdfsupply.com. We offer exchange programs, new and remanufactured products, and same day shipping. So if that's something that you need or interests you, please see us at pdfsupply.com. Thank you.